It's Sonic the Hedgehog. He's the little blue mammal that nearly toppled Mario's supremacy as the most recognizable video game character in the world. This is a rare series that has stood the test of time. Since the introduction of Sonic in 1991 on the Sega Genesis, the series has racked up over 70 million units sold across many different platforms, and it all started with a company contest. In the 1980s, the Nintendo Entertainment System absolutely dominated the home console market. Hardware and software sales were both firmly in Nintendo's favor. Sega's Master System was a fine little console in its own right, but with the NES holding more than 90% of the market, few gamers and developers had loyalty to the Sega brand. But Sega was aggressive. The time had come for the 16-bit era of gaming, and with Sega's launch of the powerful Genesis console, the company needed a mascot. Nintendo had Mario, and nearly every American, even non-gamers, knew who he was. He was a true cultural icon. The closest thing Sega had to a mascot was Alex Kidd. It was time for a fresh face, so the call went out to the employees of Sega: make the next great video game hero. Enter Naoto Oshima, an artist at Sega who took the project head on. He wisely enlisted the help of programmer Yuji Naka. Naka was already an established Sega programmer, having worked on games like Phantasy Star 1 and 2, as well as Ghouls and Ghosts. The challenge for Naka here was twofold: showcase the Sonic character and showcase the power of the new Sega Genesis hardware. Oshima figured that if his design was going to win the company's competition, he had better go into the presentation with more than just a few drawings. He wanted an early build of the game and some merchandising ideas. Above all, Sonic needed an attitude, something to attract players to the character. Part of this new character's attitude would stem from a very practical aspect of gaming. See, in those days, few games featured a save system. So a player had to complete the game in one sitting, or pause the game and leave the system on overnight, much to the chagrin of parents. To master the game, a player would be forced to play the first stage over and over and over again. This meant that the player would be very good at the first stage. Yuji Naka wanted to make it possible for the player to speed through levels that they had mastered, so Sonic was given super speed. This speed led to a more irreverent attitude for Sonic. The Blue Hedgehog was the newest, fastest thing on the market. Sega's marketing team wanted to make Mario appear slow and old. Commercials of the time unapologetically attacked the Nintendo juggernaut. So the character was designed, a game concept was built, merchandising prototypes were done, and it was time for Oshima's team to present to the higher-ups at Sega. Of course, Sonic was selected, and it was time to go into full production. Everything was looking up for Sonic. The game was shaping up to be a very impressive visual feast, the fast gameplay was fun, and the Sega marketing machine was doing their absolute best to make this game a hit. It was clear that the game needed music that would match the attitude of the character. Sega selected Masato Nakamura, a bass guitarist and songwriter for the Japanese pop music sensation Dreams Come True. The band had some successful albums, including a number one bestseller called Wonder 3 in 1990. Nakamura seemed perfect for the job. For Anthony and Nicola Caulfield's 2011 documentary entitled Sonic, The Birth of an Icon, Nakamura explains his experience working on Sonic the Hedgehog like this.
I didn't treat Sonic as a game, but a film. You know, of course, a graphic is great and it has a very strong story. So I thought, oh, this is a movie, film. So I wanted to create a movie music.
Because he only had illustrations and static screenshots to use as inspiration, Nakamura had to rely on descriptions of the gameplay from the production staff.
So Sonic staff explained to me, you know, it's going to be like this, it's going to be like this. And I started, you know, writing songs, but I will never know, because that was a totally new for me. Just because, you know, I wanted to treat Sonic the Hedgehog as a film, my inspiration comes from each graphic, you know, each stages. So if I can see a red color, so my music's gonna be like a, you know, volcano stuff. Or if I can see a Iceland, you know, I wanted to create a kind of icy music. So my inspiration came from visual or graphic. At the same time, the Mega Drive system, the sound system is very limited. Maybe we could use four sound or at the same time. So it was really, really tricky, you know. But that limitation, you know, inspired me a lot.
The staff at Sega wanted a score that would match the fun and fast platforming action. They got one of the most recognizable scores in video game history. Despite the system's technical limitations in the audio department, Nakamura delivered a great score. To gain perspective on Nakamura's style and why Sonic's music has gained a ton of fans, let's take a look at the music of the game's very first zone. This piece captures the spirit of Sonic's character in many different ways. Firstly, the piece begins with a fast series of notes that steadily rise in pitch. Then those familiar Sega Genesis drum and bass sounds enter. They give the player a steady beat which serves to push the player through the level. The melody is memorable. It has a certain attitude, just like the character Sonic. The catchiness of the melody could be from the composer's use of a very small range of pitches. This simply means that the melody will be hummable or singable. It also has just the right amount of rhythmic activity, through syncopation, to make the melody interesting. There is one factor that I'd like to touch on in relation to the melody. Nakamura cleverly works a counter melody into the piece. See, when composing or analyzing music, one must think about how the music is layered. It's like a painting. There are images in the foreground, background, and in between. The same is true for music. So let's say that the bass, drums, and other elements are more or less background. They are the foundation on which the other layers depend. Then there's the melody, which is absolutely foreground. That's the part you hum along to when listening. Then there's this other layer that musicians call counter melody. When the melody reaches a moment where it does not move, another melody comes in so that the piece doesn't seem empty or hollow. It begins as a short embellishment. Then it becomes a completely other melody played at the same time as the main melody. Notice that the counter melody moves near the end of the phrase at times when the main melody is moving the least. This really helps to feel the texture of the piece, and it leaves listeners something to discover as they listen to this track multiple times. Remember, this game was designed to be defeated in a single sitting, so the player will play the first level many times as they master more and more of the game. That melody and counter-melody combination really capture the mood of the game. But before the melody enters the piece, there's a quirky introduction. In most retro video games, tracks are written so that the entire piece can be repeated. Looped music saves space on a very limited cartridge. This piece repeats also, but the repeated section doesn't include the introduction. For reference, here's the entire introduction. Once the introduction is heard for the first time, it is never looped. This is slightly unusual for games at that time. Digging a little deeper, we also find something else interesting about the introduction. But before we dive right in, I need to provide some context. This will be a terribly brief introduction on how chords work in music. Most music is written to be tonal, meaning that there's a single note and chord that is more important than all of the others. Tonal music is built on chords called triads. Each chord has three notes. That is why you might see some music labeled in C major or in A minor. In the case of C major, C is the most important pitch in the piece, and the major triad built on C is the most important chord in the piece. The chord built on the first pitch of the scale is called tonic. This is home, this is the goal, and it's the most important chord in the piece. Most pieces begin and end on the tonic chord. It is the very top of the chord pyramid. The second level of chord importance is the dominant level. These chords sound as if they want to move to the tonic. Think of these chords as the gateway to the tonic. The chords with dominant function are 5 and 7. The next level below dominant is called predominant. These chords sound like they want to go to the dominant. The chords with predominant function are 4 and 2. Now we have enough chords to explain most of the music that we listen to today. Here's an example of a song that uses predominant, dominant, and tonic chords. There's only one other level beneath predominant, and it's called mediant. These chords are used less frequently, and they lead to chords that have predominant function. The mediant chords are 3 and 6. Here's an example of a song that uses a mediant chord.
When the night has come, and the land is dark, and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling,
this system of using chords does not nearly explain every piece ever written, but it does explain most of them. Most classical music and most popular music use this hierarchy to create drama and musical narrative. So, back to Nakamura's music for Green Hill Zone. The introduction does not present the tonic chord first, as we can now expect. He actually begins the piece on the dominant 5 chord. He remains on the chord for an extended period of time. This is a time-honored technique used by composers to ratchet up the tension. Often, this technique is called standing on the dominant, or dominant prolongation. In this case, Nakamura stands on the dominant until just before the melody enters. At that point, the dominant finally moves to tonic, and the listener might feel a sense that the music has opened up or resolved. Nakamura's score has received much praise, and of course the series has gone on to produce so many games that they're difficult to count. 20 years after the 1991 release of the first game, on October 19th, 2011, the official soundtrack for Sonics 1 and 2 was released in Japan. This was the proper music release that gamers had been waiting for. Unfortunately, if you want this 3-disc gem, be prepared to shell out some serious cash. Because of importing fees and whatnot, you'll be lucky to get your hands on this soundtrack for less than $35. If you would like access to the music and the game itself, at the title screen, press up, down, left, right, then hold A and press start. This will take you to a level skip screen. Down towards the bottom, there will be a menu item called Sound Select. Here you can flip through all of the music of the game as well as the sound effects. When it comes to getting your hands on a copy of the game, there are a ton of re-releases available. There is, of course, the original cartridge on the Sega Genesis. Most other releases have been on compilation discs. There are the two Genesis re-releases of this game in Sonic Classics and Genesis 6-Pack. There's Sonic Jam on the Sega Saturn, Sega Smash Pack for the Sega Dreamcast, Sonic Mega Collection for the Nintendo GameCube, Sonic Mega Collection Plus, which came out on the PS2, Xbox, and PC, Sega Genesis Collection for the PS2 and PSP, Sonic's Ultimate Genesis Collection for the Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3, and finally, Sonic Classic Collection for the Nintendo DS. Additionally, Sonic the Hedgehog is available for download on the Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and the Wii in their respective retail download services. Further, Android and Apple smartphones and tablets have versions of this title for download. I'm sure I've even missed a few. I really enjoy having the original cartridge, but I also highly recommend Sonic's Ultimate Genesis Collection on the PS3 or Xbox 360. It's an absolutely fantastic compilation of many of the great titles for a great price. No matter how you play it, enjoy this great classic platformer and its outstanding music. So, be sure to like, subscribe, and leave a comment below. Thanks for watching.